Welcome to Tips from the Shop. I'm Mike Greenshields and welcome to the Hobby People Workshop. Today, we're going to be talking about some customer emails and feedback that we've gotten. You know, the first shows that we've had have been really successful. From my point of view, I've really enjoyed the customer feedback, talking to other modelers about their airplanes and radios and installations, the other subjects that we've talked about. So today's show is one of those emails. A customer, fellow modeler had a question, and we're going to read the email and talk about it, and I'm going to give you some information about his question. So without further ado, here we go. So this is from Bill from Duncan, Oklahoma. And Bill writes, "Hey Mike, I've been flying an RC simulator for 2 years, and actual RC airplanes for almost a year." So, you know, Bill's new to the hobby, and you know, that's cool. I really love talking to new modelers and trying to get them started. You know, some of our emails have been from guys who have been modeling a long time, 40, 50 years, frankly, a little longer than I've been alive, and that's great too. But it's really fun to get new guys started in the hobby. So he says, "I currently fly all ready-to-fly versions of my aircraft. I would like to spread my wings a little bit and take on a P&P or ARF version for my next plane. But I'm just not sure what all of that entails. So I was hoping that perhaps one show or segment of a show could explain and maybe walk through the process of gathering the required pieces and putting together a non-ready-to-fly airplane. Thanks in advance. As I've already subscribed to your YouTube channel, I'm looking forward to the series. Best of luck, Bill from Duncan, Oklahoma." So we're going to talk about a receiver-ready airplane, choosing equipment to make it go, and that's what today's Tips from the Shop's all about. So over here, we've got some equipment. And, you know, when you buy a ready-to-fly, it's got the charger, it's got the battery, if it's glow, probably doesn't come with fuel and that sort of thing, and you've had to buy a, starter box, you know, your standard box like I have with the fuel and the glow plug igniter and all that. But for electric, that's what we're going to talk about mostly today. We've got a couple of different chargers here. The first one is the Activator EZ. And the Activator EZ is a very easy to use, thus the name, charger, but it's actually very advanced. It is a 50 watt charger, it's AC-DC. It'll charge nickel metal hydride batteries or it will charge LiPos, and it does it all automatically. So up to 50 watts, it's going to evaluate your battery when you plug it in and decide what rate to charge at. Really like this charger for either new guys or guys like my dad. He never programmed the VCR, didn't really care to program the VCR, really hates all that stuff. This thing's a no-brainer. You just plug it in and it does it. And if it doesn't like what you hooked up, it beeps at you and has all kinds of warnings. For those of you who are a little more, you want to get into the details and cycle and charge all your batteries and every kind of battery in your house or something, we have the Activator 50. And the Activator 50 is also a 50 watt AC-DC charger, but it's digital. And it is a multi-chemistry charger. It'll charge LiPos, LiFE cells, lead acid, nickel metal hydrides, NiCads, and it'll cycle. It will condition, it will evaluate your LiPos for internal resistance, and it'll even put them in a storage mode for you, and you can set up charging profiles and all kinds of stuff. It's programmable. So those of you who like a little more technical side of things, I would choose this charger. I do happen to use both. I like the Activator EZ simplicity, and when I've got like transmitter batteries, I just plug them in and I don't have to think much about them, and they're done in an hour and I'm ready to go. And I am using LiPos in my transmitter, that's why I say that. So you have to choose a charger, and you have to choose one that's right for you. If you're flying big, giant airplanes that use 12 cells, you're going to need a 200 or 400 watt charger. You're going to need a big charger. But for most park flyers, 40 size airplanes or smaller, one of these chargers would be great. For our P51, I have selected two batteries to show you. You will have to get a battery if you're getting a receiver-ready airplane or a ARF. Now, when you're choosing the battery, it's specific to the product. So you do have to go through the manual. You're just going to have to look at the manual and say, well, it uses this battery or that battery, and then find the closest thing you can at your hobby shop, wire it up, and you're ready to go. In the case of the P51, it's already wired, and these plugs are compatible, so these batteries are already ready to go. It's a 3-cell and a 4-cell. What's neat about our P51 is it can use 4 cells if you need more power, you're flying at higher altitudes where you just want more power, just to get it to fly. You know, you're up at 4,000 or 5,000 feet above sea level, you probably want that bigger battery. So you do have to choose the battery according to the model. You know, so you get a universal charger pretty much, but you have to get a specific battery that works with the airplane. If you don't get the right battery, you could burn up the motor, you could burn up the speed control. If your speed control is not compatible with LiPos, you could damage the battery because it might over-discharge the battery because cutoff levels are different. So it's really important that you get the correct battery size and type for your model. And if you're going to deviate from that, you need to make sure that the equipment is compatible, or you might have to switch out that equipment as well. Over here, we have a couple of different radios. If you're going to go into plug-and-play kind of planes, the receiver-ready kind of planes, whatever brand airplane you've decided to buy, they use different nomenclature, you will have to choose a radio. So I've got a couple of different examples here, and I think these well represent all the different kinds of radios in the market. First, you have an entry-level 6-channel. And this is the Airtronics Aquila 6. This is a 10-model memory digital radio. It's programmable. It's got digital trims. You can program helicopters or airplanes with it. It's a great entry-level computer radio. It's a great sport radio. If you're not going to fly big, complicated airplanes that need all this special programming, this is a great radio to start with. And all the brands have a great 6-channel of some sort or another. Obviously, we fly Airtronics here, so this is what I'm showing you. The 10-channel, if you are thinking in the back of your mind, gosh, I really want to fly big scale airplanes, or I want to do aerobatics, I want to fly pattern, I want to get into more specific competition, probably you're going to want a competition level radio. And the SD10GS that we're showing here does all that. It flies sailplanes, it flies power planes, it flies pattern planes, it flies helicopters, and it's got all kinds of programming. And that's more money though. So you have to kind of decide in your head what you really need. If you just need 6 channels, this is great. If you need something more advanced and you're thinking you may as well, I really want to do all this stuff, you may as well spend the extra money and get a little bit more radio if you can afford it now. But either end is probably going to be great. And it says receiver ready, which means it doesn't come with the receiver either. So you're going to have to get a receiver. So a lot of these radio systems do come with a receiver, but if you already have a transmitter, you'll have to go get another receiver that matches that transmitter. That brings up one other great question. Some airplanes are already have a receiver in them. If it's 2.4 and it's already got a receiver in it, that receiver is only going to work with a specific brand. So you can't mix brands. So if you've got a receiver that's already in the plane and you don't have that kind of transmitter, you'll have to get a new receiver and plug it in. And for any of the bigger planes like the P51 here, that's no problem to pop the receiver out and put in another one. Our customers do it all the time. So this is the equipment you'll need. In basic. Now, you can go crazy. You know, they make $2,000 radios and $500 chargers, and if you want to get all that, that's great. Just know that I fly with a 10-channel radio, and it flies all of these airplanes. And I use this 50-watt charger all the time. Works great. I do have a 200-watt charger as well because I fly big jets, and they have big, giant batteries, and you're going to need that kind of equipment. But I still use the 50-watt all the time because all these size airplanes, it works great with. And if you're doing RC cars as well, this charger will work with those too. So you can kind of do two birds, one stone there. One other thing, he said in his email, he said, ready to flies. Now I'm going to do ARFs and receiver readies. So I just wanted to show, I got a couple of ARFs almost ready to fly. And what almost ready to fly means is there's no equipment in it at all. There's no motor, there's no speed control, there's no servos. So along with the equipment I just recommended, you will have to get the correct servo for your plane and the correct motor and speed control. Even if you're doing a kit like this Alien Aircraft Taylor Craft here, we have a glow engine in here and you'll have to choose the correct glow engine. The good news is the instruction manual always walks you through that stuff. Very, very few products today don't have that information just right in the box, you know? They want you to be successful too, so they're gonna give you their recommendations. It's just a matter of choosing what you like better. Many of the planes from VQ, for example, like this Fly Baby, can be flown glow or electric, so you just get to choose. You know, I really like electric, so you're gonna stick with it. Yeah, I really wanna try glow, so you can put a glow motor in it. It'll do either one. So, when you get that new airplane, I just wanted to show you a couple of quick tips. When you first stick it together, don't put the propeller on and don't hook up the controls. Here's why. When you first plug in everything, maybe the servos aren't centered. Maybe the speed control hasn't been programmed. Maybe your radio doesn't have the servos in the right direction, or maybe the centering's different. And those could all move. The motor could fire up on you. The servos could go all the way to one end because the servo was set up for a different movement, or maybe it wasn't set up at all. You know, the hobby people receiver-ready planes tend to be really close on the servo centering. But let's say you got an airplane secondhand from one of your friends. Well, maybe he didn't center the servos so well and he was using a whole bunch of sub-trim, the secondary trim and the computer radios to get that servo centered. So when you plug in yours, the servo travels all the way to the one end, jams, and fails. We don't want that. So what I do is I hook up everything without the final control linkage put on so that I can be ready to unplug it if it does do that, and I'm not gonna break anything. Some airplanes, you can actually have the servo travel so far that it breaks the control surface right out, and you don't want that either. So I just leave everything disconnected and fire everything up and see what happens. And make a decision about what to do. You might have to go in here to the servos and recenter the servo wheel on the servo itself. You may have to reverse the servo to make it work the correct direction. Maybe the reversing is incorrect on your transmitter, so it fired up the motor right away. We don't want to have any of that happen. So for safety's sake, we take the prop off, we disconnect the last portion of the control throw here, or if it's easier, you can pop off the servo arm, and that'll make sure that you don't jam everything. Now, the other thing I want to recommend is, even though these radios, like these computer radios, have this great feature called sub-trim or centering, you still want everything to be as neutral as possible without using that stuff. So I always like to start with a fresh model in my transmitter. I like to have everything set to 0, 0, make sure all the trims are centered, and have a fresh slate. Then I hook everything up and I try to get the servo wheels as close to center as possible, and then adjust the linkage to get it as close to center as possible. So I'm using that electronic centering as little as possible just for fine tuning. And these radios do a great job of that. Now the other nice thing with these radios and a lot of computer radios today is you can run individual or you can run two servos into one channel. So in the case of my P51 here, with the 6-channel radio, everything's wide. It goes through a Y harness and into one channel. If you do that, it's even more critical that all the linkage be square and straight before you start. If you're using the SD10G, you've got extra channels and you can allow the radio to mix the two servos together so that you don't have to Y them. But either way, you still want to start with everything square and straight. I wanted to give one other tip on this P51. A lot of customers have said, well, gosh, if I have to service the motor or I want to upgrade it, or because, you know, people can't leave anything alone, including me. My P51 actually has a speed control that I test. I actually just cut the end right off, and I use magnets to hold it on. And these are just little cheap magnets you get from Radio Shack or wherever. And now the cowl goes right on and holds on in place. So that's the show for today. If you have any other questions, please email me at heymike@hobbypeople.net. Be sure to subscribe if you're watching for the first time. We got lots of other episodes to watch, and I'd sure like to have you see them and send me emails if you have any questions. And I look forward to seeing you next time from Tips from the Shop. Have comments, questions, or opinions? Email me now. The address is heymike@hobbypeople.net. Subscribe and see all our shows on YouTube.